Welcome to Middle Grade Madness at the North Texas Teen Book Festival, your annual display of clownish and foolish behavior by your favorite authors, usually joined by you, the kids, where you come up on stage and join us in crazy games of truth or dare. But this year, as you know, we have to be apart and we are coming to you from our homes, meaning therefore it's just us that are making fools of yourselves and you get to sit at home and point at your screen and talk about how ridiculous we all are. But it's your favorite cast of characters, the same authors you see every year on stage at North Texas. We've got Sarah Mlynowski, we've got Christina Soontornvat, we got Stuart Gibbs, we've got James Ponti, we've got Gordon Korman, and we got Max Brallier. And we're all here from our various houses all across the country, ready to play a game of middle grade madness scavenger hunt. And here is how it's going to go. Each author is going to present a challenge to the other authors from their book, right? So like a bad example might be find something smelly, right? Because their book is about things that stink. So we will all have to run around and find something smelly in our house and bring it back. And the author who gives that challenge will then judge and pick a winner based on the specific challenge, right? So it'll all come down to how clever we are in finding things in our apartment or house. And those of us with bigger houses, that may or may not be an advantage. We'll see if they can find things on time. And I'm going to start things off with round one to give you a sense of how everything is going. And then we'll move on to the other authors. And we'll hopefully get through a couple rounds. So you'll learn a lot about our books in the process. So, all right, we're going to start with me. And I write the School for Good and Evil series. I'm Soman Chainani. And because the School for Good and Evil is about good or evil, and I am specifically evil in the School for Evil, my challenge to all my fellow authors is in the next 2 minutes, you guys have 2 minutes to find something. I want you guys to find something evil in your house, as evil as you can, something that would fit in the School for Evil or represent the School for Evil. Ready, set, go. All right, off they go. And I'm going to tell you about my book in the process because otherwise you'd be staring at a lot of screens of authors running around. So I write the School for Good and Evil series, which is a 6-book series that started coming out in 2013, and it's all done now, but it's being made into movies by Netflix. And the first movie comes out in 2022. We just announced the cast for it. It stars Charlize Theron and Kerry Washington, as well as Sophia Wiley from the High School Musical series, and Sophia Ann Caruso, who's a tremendous actress who's gonna play Sophie. And it's the story of two girls who go to the School for Good and Evil, one who everyone thinks is the good girl, one who everyone thinks is the evil girl, and they get switched into the wrong schools. And the question is why they get switched into the wrong schools. So if you are a fan of Harry Potter and Disney and Beyonce concerts, I feel like my books combine all three things with a little bit of a devilish edge. So think Harry Potter, but a lot darker and more wicked. And that is the School for Good and Evil. So we're gonna see how our authors did with this challenge. Let's make sure everybody is back because I'm coming to you on my phone and everybody's back. So I'm going to judge and be judge, jury, and executioner. And if somebody has something that's particularly terrible, I'm gonna be mean to them. So let's see how everybody did. Okay, Sarah. You're up first.
Ooh.
Oh, that's pretty good. That is pretty good. That's as evil as we can get, right? That is, the Satan is pretty evil.
Okay. That was a costume from last year. There you go.
Pretty good. Christina, your turn. What do you got?
Okay, I was gonna put this on, but it's my daughter's and it's too small, so I can't get it on. It's Harley Quinn's jacket. Ooh. See, she's totally pretty evil. Good.
She's pretty evil. Harley Quinn is pretty evil. That's a good one, too. Oh, these are tough. Everyone's saying really well. Stuart, you are up next.
All right. I have the most evil thing I could find, a teenage girl.
That's good.
That'll be tough to beat. Tough to beat. James.
Yes.
How about you?
Okay. So I was born in Italy, and there were fortune tellers that lived near where we were, and one of them taught my mother how to tell fortune. So I have 50-year-old deck of fortune telling cards from Italy. I don't know
pretty
if that's
good.
Evil that, or magical,
pretty,
or Some people think it's evil, but yeah.
I'm absolutely sure it would predict an evil fate for me. All right, Gordon, you're up next.
Okay, I just got to say these are all way too obvious, but this is an electronic adapter that was very expensive and supposedly was going to solve all the problems of the electrical system in my house, and it does not work. Only someone truly evil could have designed this instrument of torture and psychological pressure. So I suggest this one.
we're all speechless. Uh-huh. Even Max is speechless. All right, Max, you're up next.
Thanos.
Yeah, but oh, come on. That's like a cutesy like Disney version of Thanos.
I mean, he's kind of cute, but he still got the Infinity Stones.
That's like legit black magic here, right?
That looks like the Thanos you cuddle. Like that's a Thanos you give to like a 4-year-old.
I know that one snapped once and got rid of half of all Max's toys. So
I don't know. Whoever designed that one gets a D- for accuracy.
But he's so cute. Evil cute.
Too cute. Okay, this seems to be an obvious one. I have to give it to Stuart because teenage girls tend to be quite devilish in general. So I will declare him the winner of round one, which is coincidental because now he's up next.
All right. So my book here is Charlie Thorne, Lost City. And in this book, Charlie's after something very ancient and mysterious that she's looking for. So I'm challenging all of you to go find the oldest thing in your home, and it can't be yourself. So. All right. So Charlie Thorne and Lost City is the second book in the Charlie Thorne series. Charlie Thorne is the smartest person on Earth, even though she's only 12. Now in the first book, thanks to her amazing intellect, Charlie was dragged into all sorts of international intrigue and adventure as she was sent off to look for a very dangerous equation that Albert Einstein had developed. But in this book, now Charlie is on the trail of something mysterious and dangerous that Charles Darwin discovered. And so Charles Darwin, as we know, famous for coming up with the theory of evolution, but quite an adventurer back when he was young. And although we know that Charles Darwin went to the Galapagos Islands, he actually spent most of his trip around the world in South America. And so Charlie is going through all sorts of amazing places around the world through South America, and she's going to encounter all sorts of dangers and mysterious things, and it should be quite a lot of fun for all of you. Just came out on March 2nd, so fresh as today's headlines. This is a very young book as opposed to what we're now going to find, because everybody here has got very old things. So someone didn't get to go last time, so I'm going to ask him what he has got for us.
So I happened to find an old journal of mine from 1994, and it starts with, I'm starting another journal, another one. For some reason, I never keep you more than a few months because I don't want people to read you and I don't want to face the stuff I have to say. So this journal will not last long.
Well, so he's got the most ironic thing so far. Sorry, let's go. I don't want to go by. Let's go with Gordon next. Here.
Okay. So I ran up and down the stairs, so I probably shouldn't have to go next. But that's okay. special pressure. I was born for. So this is a. I am from Canada originally. So Sarah, but she is not a good Canadian because she did not choose a Canadian thing.
How do you know?
But this is a very old, or you know, somewhat old, from the 1940s, soapstone carving of a ptarmigan that had been in my family for a while. You know, it's kind of boring, but here it is. It's actually kind of heavy too, so. Add that to hauling it up the stairs, but that is my old thing. Slightly older than my house, by the way, which was built in 1947.
All right, let's go with James next.
Right, I also ran up and down the stairs, which is not good. I struggle with this one. What I ended up coming up with is I'm a baseball fan, and this is the Lou Gehrig baseball card from 1933. And actually, I keep it in my office, but I didn't think about it, so I ran up and down the stairs, and it was right behind me. So a Gaudi 1933 Lou Gehrig baseball card.
All right. Sarah, what do you got?
Well, it was purchased in Canada, but that's all I got. So this, my mom gave this to me when I was 9, and then she kept it, and then I gave it to Chloe. We gave it to Chloe, my older daughter, when she was 9, and then passed it on to Annabelle, who turns 9 this summer. And then just, it was in perfect condition, and then just last week, you can see it got a little, it fell over and broke. And broke. But we glued it back together, so there you go.
If you got that at 9, that's like 50 years old, right? And that's really old.
James, you should have made the joke the other way, that you bought it last week, you know? 10 years ago, that you make it the other way.
Max, what do you got?
I have my grandfather's old hat.
Ooh.
Which for a while I wore around unironically because I thought it looked cool. And I thought it was really, really cool looking. But now it's just a thing that I have that I keep around.
Was your grandfather a newsie?
I don't think he's not a newsie, but he read the newspaper, I think, sometimes.
And Christina, what do you got for us?
Okay, I have to say, if you judge this literally the oldest thing in your house, I have a geode, and it is millions of years. What are you people thinking? Like, something from the 40s? I totally win.
And it's not surprising that the scientists among us might have actually gotten something. I love the Lou Gehrig baseball card, but Christina is right if we're going to go with science here, and that is...
Everything anyway. Does she also have to win here?
In addition to all of the other awards Christina has gotten, I will give you a seal that says Christina knows how old things are, and you can put that on your books as well.
So. It's the most meaningful. Thank you very much. I think next, right?
Yes, there you go.
So mine comes from my novel, A Wish in the Dark. This is a story where the main character escapes from a prison. And when he does, he leaves his best friend behind. So I want you to go and find something that represents best friends, your best friendship. Go find something. I'm sorry, Max, because I know you have no friends. And while they're gone, looking around, I'll tell you about the book. So this is a story of Pong, who escaped from prison. And he runs away, and he goes and hides in a temple. And he's worried about having to return to the prison, that someone's going to find out that he escaped from this prison. And he hides in a temple. He pretends to be a monk. He's in disguise for years. And then who should show up at the temple years later? It's the daughter of the prison warden. And she recognizes him, and she becomes determined to turn him in. So he has to run, escape, try to hide from her. And she is trying to track him down. And they end up in this big city that is on the brink of a revolution. This is a fantasy novel, and it is set in a Thai-inspired world. So inspired by Thailand, which is where my dad is from. Oh, look at all the people coming back with their fringe things. And very exciting. I don't have the sticker on this book, but A Wish in the Dark won a Newbery Honor Award a few weeks ago. So that's very exciting. Okay, yay, friends. Let's see. Sarah, what do you have?
All right. So my daughter, Chloe, has a best friendship necklace. I could not figure out how to get it off this thing. So I brought the whole jewelry tree, but you can see a best friendship necklace. Thank you, Chloe.
Classic. Awesome.
James. I had many of these as a kid.
Yes.
This was my best friend back when we first met. And We've been married for 31 years so far.
Aww, that's so sweet. I love it.
I'm wearing a similar shirt that day, by the way, even though it was probably 7 sizes small.
It's a classic. Shouldn't change a classic. Soman, how about you?
So my two best friends on in the writing world are Brendan Reichs and Ali Condi, and they wrote a book called The Dark Deep. And in the last book, they dedicated it to me, and they said, for Soman, best friend, best hair, best human. So this was like, it was so cute. It was nice to have it like in writing.
I remember when you announced that, and that was so sweet. That's cool. Okay, how about you, Gordon?
Okay, well, I know that most people think of me as, you know, the kind of person who can always get a table at the most exclusive restaurants and like absolutely in every way. But believe it or not, I was actually once, who would believe this, of a bald guy with glasses, a nerd. And my best friend and I were both the stars of the chess team in school. So here is our second place trophy from the middle school chess tournament, 1974-1975.
Wow. Did your friend win?
Chess is cool again. Chess is very... Yeah.
First and I was second. He had a better trophy, but he unfortunately is not on the Zoom.
All right, Max, what do you got?
Okay, Christina, I do have friends and I have proof right here. This is a photo of you. No, this is... I recently moved to Los Angeles and I made a number of A-list friends. So this is a photo of, it's the back of my head. This is a photo of me, or I'm right there, playing ping pong with Robert Redford and Paul Newman. That's me. And then that's just us. We're just kind of hanging out. I think we're at the back of there's a private area at the Chateau Marmont, and we were just, you know, just paddling.
I saw the six pack. I was like, these are not writer friends. No. We're too busy.
Gordon is on this call. He's right there.
All right, Stu.
All right, so this is my school year's journal here. Aww. And every year we had to list all of you know, our friends, and I've still got like my friend Ken Parker listed here, I met in second grade, who I still remain friends with to this day, and who doesn't even live that far away from me now.
So sweet. That's great. Good job, everybody. I love you all. You're my best friends. I'm going to pick James because that was so sweet about his wife.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And actually, we're keep doing this pattern where whoever's next seems to win, which means Gordon, you got a chance because I know you're next. But
so far, I'm kind of
awful. So my book is City Spies, my newest book. I actually... My newest series. I have a new book in the series coming out this past week. And in the story, what happens is everyone, all these spies, chooses their code name, their hometowns. So what I want you all to find, and it can't be the view out your window, so I want you to find something that speaks of what your city spy name would be. So something of your hometown or the city that you consider home, even if it's not where you were born. So a memento of home.
Okay.
All right, so the idea of City Spies is that there are 5 kids from around the world who each fallen through the cracks of their different societies. And what happens is they get adopted by a spy with British intelligence. And like I said, they take as their code names, their hometowns, and they go on these amazing adventures to cities all over the world. And the first one, it was Paris was the site of the big adventure. In the new one that's about to come out, the adventure takes place in San Francisco and in London, and they're really fun to write. They're led by a guy named Mother, which is an unusual name for your male lead, and there's a lot of spying, but there's also a lot of friendship, and there's a lot of what it means to be a family and what it means to be a unit, even if you have different backgrounds and come from all over the place. And that was about how much I had planned to talk, but I see we only have half of our team back, so I will just continue rambling. Is there a question, Christina?
Yeah, I had a question. I wanted to know, because all of your characters' names, they're named after the city. So what? How did you pick the cities? Did you just like, we were just like, those are the cool ones?
That is behind the scenes. When I knew that's what I wanted to do, I made a list of about 100 cities in the world that were also good names. Austin, where you live, was actually one of the contenders. And because I thought if you're going to call them that, it would be odd if they called each other, you know, hey, Oakland, come here. Oh, sure thing, San Diego. You know, so we wanted name cities that at least were name-ish. And I wonder, they're each on different continents. We have Paris, Brooklyn, Rio, Sydney, and Kat is from Kathmandu. So that's the one. And I see, okay, we have Max coming back from the trailer.
Yeah, that was a tough one.
We are all here and ready. So I can't wait to see what you guys found. Let's start with Soman. Soman, what did you pick up?
So my hometown's actually Miami, Florida. And growing up in Miami, we had a frog problem outside our house. And they used to come and infest our tennis court. So I always have a little like froggy
Is that frog to remind you? Because those are Miami colors. That's green and orange is perfect.
Yep, it's a Miami frog. Miami
frog? Were the frogs that big that infested?
No. They were teeny tiny, but you know.
All right, Stuart, you're up. What do you got, Stuart?
Well, I'm from Philadelphia, so I think I'd be Philly, and so I got my vintage Philadelphia Phillies baseball cap here.
All right, that's a good one. Christina?
I'm from Weatherford, Texas, and we were the Kangaroos, the Weatherford Kangaroos.
Oh, there we go. Very nice. Sarah?
I also have a baseball hat. I'm from Montreal. Yes.
Okay. But hers is vintage too. That's a team that's not around anymore. Yours is, yeah.
Exactly. The team is no longer a team. So it's even, it definitely beats Stutes. There you go.
So did you ever go to an Expos game?
Yeah. I actually, James, when did it stop being a team? I'm forgetting, but it was.
I think it was about 8 years ago. I
mean, there's still a team. Yeah. They just moved.
They're just called the Washington.
Not called the Expos anymore either, though. Yes, they moved. But so, yeah, I went to tons of games as a kid.
All right, Max was the one who was at the last moment, so he was out there searching for something perfect. What'd you come up with, Max?
So I now live in Los Angeles. I have a photo of me and some of my friends from Los Angeles. So during I grew up in Boston, but my friends and I are very far flung now, and so we all stay connected by playing VR on the Oculus Quest together every Wednesday at 8 Western, 5 Eastern. We do this.
So when you play, do you have a special nickname that you log in as?
Yes, PontiFan84.
PontiFan84, that's a good one. I thought that. That's why I teed that one up for you. And bring it home, Gordon. What touch? Is it a soap though? Or you got something different?
I live in Long Island, which is outside New York City. So keeping with the sports theme, this may not work because this is very large, but I have.
Oh my goodness. It looks like a giant something.
A life poster of Saquon Barkley.
Wow, that's pretty good.
We Giant fans have not had much to cheer about lately, but I figured I would represent even after our 6-10 season.
I think those are all excellent. The frog is so tempting as a fellow Floridian now, but I think I have to go towards Les Expos, Montreal, the hat from Sarah, because it's a classic, it's a throwback vintage hat, and I miss those colors. Those are great uniforms the Expos always had, so I miss seeing those. But the Phillies came in sixth. Don't worry, you were in the running.
No, it's okay.
All right, next up we have Mr. Gordon Korman.
All right, thank you. So my newest book is called Unplugged, and it is the story of a few kids who are sent to a sort of ultra-crunchy wellness camp for an entire summer where all the food is health food. It is the healthiest place on earth. It's called the Oasis for Mind and Body Wellness. So it's all health food. It's exercise 24/7. But most scarily, it is 100% unplugged. No phones, no technology, no computers, no TVs. nothing with a screen. So how are these kids going to survive for an entire summer in such a place? If you were sent to a place like the Oasis, I would like you to bring something unplugged, non-technology, that you could use to entertain yourself for an entire summer. So in writing unplugged, I guess my first emphasis was to find who is the worst kid in the world to be sent to a place like an Oasis. And what occurred to me is, I was thinking about Silicon Valley, you know, in California, where all the big tech companies come from, Google and Facebook and Apple. What if your dad created a company like Google? So in a way, you're like literally the prince of all technology, and you get sent for an entire summer to this place where you're not even allowed to have a phone. Or and I created this character, Jet Baranoff, whose dad is the originator and chief executive officer of Fuego, the largest tech company in the world. Bigger than Apple and Facebook and Google combined. So I guess the basic what if is just, you know, what if your dad invented like Google and you get sent to a place where you're not even allowed to have a phone? It was a really fun book to sort of explore because, you know, it sort of started with my own editor who used to go to a wellness retreat every year, and she absolutely loves it. The more she talks about it, the more I kept thinking, any kid would absolutely hate this place. What if a bunch of kids got sent to a wellness oasis? Well, it seems like all our expert contestants are in. So are we ready to represent? First, let's begin with Christina.
Okay, I brought this dude. This Google, this thing. I would just do this all the time at my wellness camp.
Yes, a Google. Okay. I knew someone was. I knew at some point today someone was going to come up with a Google. I just didn't know. But here it is. Let's write that down. We got our first Google. Okay. Awesome. How about Sarah?
I would bring a book of fairy tales because I love to reread them over and over again. And because my series, Whatever After, is about a girl who falls into fairy tales and messes them up.
All right, sounds really good. That's another good one. It doesn't have a cool word to describe it, like Guga. I think that if you know, fairy tale collections were called Gugas or something like that, like Wang Zunes, that would be like amazing, but. Under the circumstances, great try. Stuart.
I actually did spend a lot of my childhood, which was quite some time ago, without really any kind of technology. So I went with what we used back then, which is called a stick. And you could use this stick you could make it a weapon. You could play games with it. You could poke people in the eye with it. It was sort of endless. We really had a stick in our imaginations when we were growing up. And I think that if you had to go to a camp where you were removed from technology, stick would be your kind of go-to all-purpose item that you'd be playing with.
Okay, excellent. Thanks. And Stuart, by the way, you have just been banned in 37 states. James, you're up next.
Well, I want a diversity of entertainment. I want something that's going to excite me and entertain me and make me laugh and make me smarter. So I would bring the books of Christina Soontornvat. They're so diverse. There's so many of them. You could read all 13 if you want nonfiction. You want to go on a journey. It really is an endless. I was going to read the books of Stuart Gibbs. I had those with me too. But then I saw the stick and I thought, actually, maybe I'm overrating what Stu can do. So I'm switched to Christina at the last second decision there.
And by the way, the word for when you have all the books together of one specific author is a Guga of that author. All right, Max, you're up.
I have a health.
Okay. I would bring my dog, my puppy, but I don't have one, so I want a dog. So I would bring a pet, and the closest thing I have is I have this bird cage where I keep Salacious Crumb from Star Wars. He lives in this bird cage. So I would bring a pet, and this is the best that I have. So that's what I would bring. And I would wear and I would wear this hat.
All right. Ooh, I don't know that you get extra points for the hat for sure.
Extra.
I wear my winning hat.
All right, Soman, you're up.
Everyone knows I'm a tennis obsessive, so this is all I really need to be happy. I would bring my tennis racket.
Cool. Would you call the distinctive mesh pattern of that tennis racket a Guga mesh?
You know, there's a famous Brazilian player who was named Guga, so that's all I can think of when you say that word. He had big wild hair, and he was sort of a crazy man.
Well, these are all great, and as much as I would love to give it to Christina so I could say my favorite word again, I am going to have to give this one to Max. Because he does the best spit take, and because he had a two-part answer with a Star Wars character inside a bird cage and his grandfather's hat.
Wait, I just have to point out that when we're talking about bringing the collective works of any author, we should point out that nobody could bring the collected works of Gordon Korman, because they would not.
Too many of them.
97 books, they would not have room to bring anything else to camp there. So
a less modest version of myself might say, my Guga is bigger than your Guga. All right, Max, you're up, you're next.
Okay, so I write the last Kids on Earth series, which was adapted into an animated Netflix series for which I won an Emmy. So I would love you to all go get your Emmys.
You're the worst. You're the worst.
Anybody? No? Okay, then I'll do another one. I guess.
Are we not supposed to be? I'll put mine back. Okay.
Not your other awards, too. Fine. Okay. I have a backup. I had a backup. I thought it was a better crowd. Okay. So in Last Kids on Earth, there's a lot of zombies. Things are happening. People get turned into zombies. And I often think about, it would be really embarrassing if you were zombified and then like you were found and you had something like awful on you, like dirty underwear or something. So I want you all to find something really embarrassing. The last possible thing that you would want to be found in if you were a zombie and somebody found you, something very, very embarrassing. Very embarrassing. And I will talk about, okay. So I write a series called The Last Kids on Earth. And the newest book, which comes out in April, is The Last Kids on Earth, Tales from the Treehouse. And this is the first like full color, like true graphic novel. So far, The Last Kids on Earth series is like illustrated novels where it's some text and then some drawings by the wonderful Douglas Holgate. But this is six short little comics, each one full color, each one by a different illustrator. And I'm extremely excited to see the characters kind of like come to life in like big, bright, bold, flashy colors. And different illustrators do different takes on them. And they all look sort of different. And yeah, I'm really excited about Thrilling Tales from the Treehouse. There are six stories, and the big grand finale story bridges the gap between do I have it here? The Last Kids on Earth and The Skeleton Road, which was the previous book. This number was the same as I had, six. And then it bridges the gap between number six and then the next Last Kids on Earth book, which does not have a title yet. And I need a title. So if anybody has a title, let me know. I should have asked someone to find me a title. And so yeah, that's The Last Kids on Earth. And there's a lot of zombies in it that led to the desire you guys to go find some really embarrassing undead zombie. I'm going to see who else. Anybody else reach over? Let's see. Christina's sitting there by herself, which is embarrassing enough. Okay. Let's see. Do we have everybody?
We lost Soman there, dude.
Oh, hold on. I'm here. I got to duck
out. He never wants to see. I think he's
I'm here. I'm back.
All right.
Okay.
So did I call an order if I have this when? Anybody touched me before? Okay, Christina, you are first. You're first to my camera.
I don't know. This was so hard. I would be embarrassed if I was found with a pink hat and inside the hat was a potato and everybody your potato head. I don't know. I couldn't come up with anything.
I like that. That reminds me of our turnip drawing contest where I didn't know what a turnip was.
I have one. It's actually a radish, but you wouldn't know that either. You don't. I just have a feeling you wouldn't know.
You just had that. It just happened to turn up. Like
yeah.
That.
Turn up. That's what we call turnips.
Sarah?
Wait, did you say me?
Yes.
Okay.
You're next. you're next for my screen.
Oh, good. Okay, so I have a bad habit, it's not my fault. My washing machine and dryer have bad habits of eating socks. So the only pairs of socks I have left are mismatched ones. So I would not want anyone to see me. I do not have any two of the same. These are from out of print. They're all book themed socks and they're adorable. They're just none of them match.
And you're wearing them on your hands, which is not
how you're wearing a dress.
That's really embarrassing.
No, there was no socks with this. And also I thought of putting them on now, but then because I'm wearing a dress, it would be awkward to try to get them in the camera. Right. So you just have to look at them like this too.
Stuart Gibbs.
I have this hat, which actually it was given to me in Minnesota, and it's a flap hat. So in really cold weather, you buckle it down like this, and it's possibly practical, but I find really not kind of a fashion disaster.
I think it kind of looks cool, actually.
It's an award, right?
What?
It's an award, right? You won that.
I did win this. Yes, I did win this. I got a plaque. It was for the Minnesota Children's Writing Award, and then you get a flap hat. And when I was wearing this in Minnesota, I fit right in. But in Los Angeles, where I live, I feel like it looks like I don't know what I'm doing. It looks like I just escaped from a mental institution.
With or without the hat, it looks like that. Gordon is next on my screen.
Okay. Yeah. So if I was ever caught in a zombie apocalypse, I would hate to be caught dead in uncool shoes. And, you know, I mean, I'm just such an icon of fashion that just the thought of being found in uncool shoes would be terrible. But I don't know if you could see this. My one defense is these are very, very dusty. That just proves that
we can see that
I actually wore these. They were not uncool yet. So I'm going with the uncool shoes.
Those are the dustiest shoes I've ever seen. James.
All right, so we moved in the last year, and my wife managed to throw away clothes that were embarrassing, that embarrassed her when I would wear them. So I have less to choose from. I do have a Stewish hat, which would be awkward, but somehow this shirt made it. So I think this combination would be not good to be found in. I'll leave it at that.
A Stewish hat, okay. And then... Let's see, I'm on my phone. Who? Anybody else? Thank you, everybody.
No, yeah, I don't have that many embarrassing clothes, but the most embarrassing thing I have around is a lavender pillow mist that I use every night because I can't sleep without it. So I literally carry it everywhere I go, and it's the most high maintenance and embarrassing thing.
That wins 100% hands down. Everything else, hats and socks, a lavender mist bedspread that you can't sleep without. That wins every single time.
Okay, yeah. On that note, I gotta duck out, but I wanna say bye to you guys before you guys do your last challenge from Sarah. I hear it's a really good one.
Okay.
All right, I'll see you guys soon.
Bye.
Bye, Soman. Hi, so I'm Sarah, and I'm the author of Whatever After and Upside Down Magic. And in Upside Down Magic, I write this series with two other authors, with Lauren Markle and Emily Jenkins. So my challenge to you guys is to go find another author. You have 2 minutes. All right, I'm putting my timer on. So I'm the author of Whatever After, and that next Whatever After book is called Good as Gold, and it comes out in April. And in Whatever After, Abby and her brother Jonah fall into different fairy tales, mess them up, and then have to help the characters find new happy endings. And the next book in the series is Good as Gold, and Abby and Jonah fall into the story of Goldilocks and the Three Bears. And they arrive about 5 minutes into that. They arrive at the bear's cottage about 5 minutes before Goldilocks shows up. So they don't want to mess it up. So they hide under the bed. But when Goldilocks comes in, they see that she's really upset and looking for something specifically. So they decide that maybe there's a reason that she's eating everyone's porridge and breaking chairs and taking naps. So they're going to help her find what she's looking for. And that's the book 14 in the series. And there are also two special editions. And while we wait for Stu and Max, I'll tell you about the other series I have, Upside Down Magic, is about a world where everyone has magic powers. And Nori is one of the characters in the book, and her magic is a little bit wonky. So instead of going to a very fancy magic school called Sage Academy, she goes to a school called Dunwoodle, where they have a special program for kids who also have upside down magic. And the next book in this series comes out in June. It's called Night Owl. I don't have the actual book, just the printout. And the other really fun thing that happened with Upside Down Magic is that it's now a movie on Disney Plus. So you can watch it there. It came out on the Disney Channel over the summer, and it's now on Plus. And I got to go watch the filming. I have not won an Emmy yet. Like Max.
That's around the corner. That's around the corner.
Right. I did really enjoy getting to see them film it. I have a picture here that I could show of Isabella Rose or Nori. This is my girls and I on set, and we just had so much fun going to see it and learning about it. Max, did you get to go to, I guess you get to go to set because it's animated. Can you talk about
it? I did. It was like, have you ever seen Roger Rabbit? It's a lot like that. It's sort of how, yeah, it was very cool. And then I solved the murder. Play patty cake.
Gordon, you've had TV stuff done.
Who are we missing? What's going on here?
Yeah, I've had a few things done over the years too. It's a really cool experience to watch your story on TV. My Emmy got lost in the mail though, so I don't know. It might have been sent to Max's house by mistake.
In all seriousness, I was nominated for an Emmy a couple years ago, and I lost, and so it hurts actually to see that Max could win one and I would lose, but that's all right.
Okay, so let's see, while we're waiting, James, do you want to?
I think I found an author.
Author is, we should start. James, we'll now.
Okay, so I did win an Emmy. So unlike Max, I didn't win an Emmy, but I did win an award that is an author. So here is Edgar Allan Poe.
Awesome.
Heard of him.
For some reason, I thought he'd be bigger.
Well, he's aged.
Gordon Korman.
Next, Gordon, you're next.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't actually have another author physically here, but I did work on a multi-author series called The 39 Clues for a while, and we had our own 39 Clues agent cards printed. So as you can see, we've got, that was me, but this is Rick Riordan, Peter Larangis, Jude Watson, Patrick Carman. I really don't know who this is. Margaret Peterson Haddix, and yours truly. So that was a really cool experience. And these cards remain the closest thing to another author that I have in this house.
Well done. Christina?
I also have cards that represent my favorite authors. Sarah, the queen.
Oh!
James, jack of all trades. Gordon, the king. Stu is the Joker. Max, wild card!
Oh!
Oh, he's a wild card, that guy.
I was really hoping you were going to pull the number two card.
All right, I guess Max, you're next.
Oh, I have a bobblehead of my favorite author. This is me. So I have a bobblehead of Max Brallier, and I found he's the closest thing I have to another author near here. So that's what okay. I got.
Stu, are you anywhere around?
Here,
Stu?
Yeah. I'm here. I got Max Brallier. I know Gordon and James are making a big deal about how they had to go up and down the stairs to find somebody, but I ran over to Max's house. I got Max Brallier. I got like the greatest author who lives close to me.
You know? I didn't know we live close to each other.
No, we don't. I mean, you know, it's a couple miles, but
oh gosh.
I crossed state lines, but
that's pretty good.
I feel like maybe I work
hard. Not as good as this.
But the problem is, and Gordon, correct me if I'm wrong here, weren't the rules that you had to bring the thing back to your chair, though? Like, does that count? I guess it's up for you to decide. So I thought you were supposed to go get an author.
I have to give that to Stu, guys. I have to give it to Stu.
So, Stu, another 60 yeah. seconds. Hit Max over the head and bike him back home.
I hit him over the head with his Emmy.
How many pictures of Paul Newman and Robert Redford does he have scattered around the office?
Well, that closet back there has about 1,300 of them.
I signed him and give him out. Like, you
know. Amazing.
All right. Well, Stu, are you going to wrap us up? Is that how we...
Take it out home.
I do want to thank everybody for joining us for Middle Grade Madness, the home version. I hope you guys have all enjoyed it. We've had a good time. I'm exhausted. I mean, God, this was a long way to go.
You're breathing very hard.
I know, I'm breathing hard. I have my, luckily I've got my North Texas Teen Book Festival mask up, everybody. So thank you guys for joining us. Lots of other great panels coming. So tune in all day to those. All right. And hopefully next year we'll be back in person.
I'm like this, where we're not in person.
I don't know what your next panel is, Stu, but you got to get back to your desk.
Okay. Jeez. Yeah, I know.
You have a panel in three.
See you guys.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. Get out of my house, please.